bird had just died. And my dad got me two more. And I was like, I was really happy and all. And suddenly Rippan comes along and he's like, how can you put a bird in a cage? What's wrong with you? And he just opened the cage and let them go. And I just stood there and I looked at him like, I don't believe you did this, you know.
We didn't really know why our parents decided to call us Rippan and Vippan. In later years, it seemed quite absurd. It also meant being always dressed in the same clothes, and no clear identity, you know, between the two of us as such.
Even their voice was so similar, and I think they took delight in, you know, confusing people as to who was who.
Rippan and Vippan were pretty famous when we were in school. All their nefarious activities were, you know, big thrill in the convent school.
The principal called our parents and said, we can't handle this anymore, so please take them out and put them in another school. We were moved out of that school.
Even when he was very small, his kind of impishness or naughtiness, as you would call it, but it was always related to, you know, it wouldn't explode in harming anybody. It would always end with a kind of compassion.
He lived overlooking a slum, and he never got over that. He used to talk about that, and we were about the same age as those kids that he was talking about.
I was never surprised about his tremendous effort to start CRY, because he was committed even then. He saw the purpose of life very much earlier than his contemporaries.
I was not really concerned, or I had not questioned what life was at that stage. And he was very, very sensitive. His sensitivity is what kind of differentiated both of us.
You know, he had this lovely humor, so even if it was some great intense passion, then he could dissolve it with his own idiotic wackiness.
He did some horrid thing to me. He did lots of times, but one was the worst.
We called up Sunita. He made me call up because Sunita didn't really know my voice. I hadn't met her. And then he would say, madam, I'm calling from MAFCO. You're placing order for 500 chicken. So we are just confirming the order.
I didn't believe it completely, but I didn't want to disbelieve it. If 800 chickens got dropped at my door, I would die. Who would pay for them? And then Yesha kept saying, of course I knew later it was Yesha saying, but I will lose my job and please don't do this. It's been ordered. Is this your address? Is this your phone? And then I eventually called the servant at home and said, please, Teresa, don't accept one chicken if it's not. And then I think the next day he called and said, did you get that chicken? And
I always see him laughing, you know, with his shoulders would go up and down. His whole body would shake. And he had this really puckish humor. And sometimes, at really critical moments, like you're in the middle of this fight, this argument, and suddenly he would start laughing because he was looking over your head out of the window and he saw two pigeons making love or something. He would start laughing.
Rippan Kapoor ko aap aise sadharan vyakti nahi the, wo ek yug purush the. Ab dekhiye, Rippan ne jab socha ki main mujhe kuch karna hai, jab hum aur Vardha mein mile, Rippan bhai aur hum, तो मैंने कहा, रिपन भैया, आप तो बड़े अच्छे एरोप्लेन में सर्विस करते हैं, बड़े बड़े लोगों से मिलते हैं, आपका तो बड़ा अच्छा सर्विस है, आपको ये समाज सेवा की कैसे सूझ गई? तब उन्होंने ये कहा था कि मुझे लगा कि मेरे जीवन का, अब यहाँ भी देखिए आप उन्हीं का बात, कि वो कह रहे हैं कि मुझे लगा, भंवर बहन, कि मेरे जीवन का उपयोग सिर्फ सर्विस करना और पेट भरना नहीं, मेरे जीवन का उपयोग हजारों लोगों के लिए.
One can get motivated out of various platforms. It can be intense desires, can be intense desire to achieve, or on the other side, it could be an intense reaction to a trauma or a suffering. In Rippan's case, I thought it was more the second.
Maybe as a child, he felt that he hadn't been given sufficient nourishment emotionally. That perhaps these children needed nourishment both emotionally and socially, and physically, and spatially, who knows? Maybe that was a child in him, wanting to be refurbished again.
the conflicts, the turmoils he was going through, he made something positive out of it, you know, by starting CRY. And I think a lot of his work, which he's done, is an outcome of his conflicts, his personality.
He felt very strongly about the fact that adults didn't respect children and adults didn't give children what they needed. You know, he always talked about that. You know?
I think he wanted every child to have everything which he felt a child deserved. Not just physical or material well-being, but happiness, joy, fun, growth, stimulation, the capacity to think, to live life, you know, as fully as he was doing.
He became a new person within himself, confident, surer, you know. I found that after he started CRY, he had found what he was searching for.
You know, there was a friend of his who had a motorbike and who was very much this macho kind of fun-loving, you know, let's go here, let's go there kind of chap. Now, he wasn't one bit interested in anything Rippan was doing or, well, he kept saying, I don't care about all this stuff. So Rippan said, but you've got a lovely bike and it goes, moves past, so you just take us wherever. And this chap did so much work for us. It was amazing. We could have not done without him. Cabs were absolutely unaffordable. And it's amazing, but he just made you feel, it's not that you want to feel important at all, but he made you feel that wherever it was possible, great, I can use your skills.
I think the difference was mainly because of the you. It's child relief and you, and nobody had ever made use of that idea. Where we were going, we were not going across and saying, okay, I want money or buy my cars. But we were saying, well, you know, you can do something. You can make a change.
For us, the way we'd begun, it was so much more fulfilling for me personally to be directly with the people we were concerned with. And I think he loved it too then. But I think that he felt so much more could be achieved by people who were far more skilled than we are.
Sansta to koi bhi khol lenge, garibon mein kaam koi bhi kar lenge. Lekin un logon ke liye, jo garibon ke liye kaam kar rahe hain, hum unke liye kaam karein. Unke liye sansadhan jutayein, unke liye paisa jutayein, unke liye avashyakta jutayein. To hum ek kadi ban sakte hain. Pehli kadi logon ke beech kaam karne walon ki, dusri kadi logon ke support, madad dene walon.
It is very important to have this link. In a sense that one is not looking for CRY support only in terms of finance. It is also looking for the support in terms of agenda. That child is a major agenda for any voluntary work. And that, I think, is the credence CRY gives to our program.
He was an absolute and total dreamer in the true sense of the word. He never looked at constraints, only at possibilities and potential. And his dreams were grand. They were grandiose dreams, which perhaps another person would call crazy or mad. In fact, he would often walk into the office and, you know, he'd be sort of shaking that plastic cigarette he used to hold to avoid smoking. And you know how he would be full of this kind of nervous energy and he'd say, I had an idea last night, but of course you'll think I'm mad.
He was going to bring these two English clowns from England. And they were going to walk off an Air India plane on stilts, you know, and then they were going to come into town and entertain the children.
I thought, terrific idea, but who's going to do it, you know? Because I used to keep thinking that this guy is going to be out, you know, flying to New York or London or wherever it is, but, you know, how is this going to happen out here?
He's used this opportunity which Air India has given him, the travel, you know, the possibilities of interacting with people internationally.
The clowns that he, you know, brought to India, that again, I think he happened to meet them somewhere in Europe, if I remember correctly. And he came back very excited.
That picture was on the front page of almost every newspaper, these clowns on stilts walking off a plane. So Rippan had that. I mean, in his quiet way, he had this real showman in him. And I think it worked to the advantage of Cry.
Every detail, you know, every single thing that he had told me was actually happening. This is an incredible, capacity that he had was not only to conceptualize big ideas, but to execute them to the last detail. I haven't met too many people like that.
That was one thing about Rippan. He could not stay out of the nitty-gritty of anything in Cry. I mean, as much as we tried to sort of, compartmentalize different activities, I remember even a simple thing like opening the mail. We told Rippan, you are not to open the mail that comes into Cry because it has to be entered into a register. But I remember the minute he'd walk in the door, and it was generally earlier than everybody else, he would make a dash for the mail.
He'd sniff out all the envelopes with the checks and cash inside. So, that was one thing very fundamental. He sat on top of the money. He would insist every week or, you know, as often as it struck him that, you know, what's the cash and, you know, how much cash do we make?
He was actually Cry's best salesperson in that sense, finally. He really was very comfortable going out and selling. He could meet any client. So, I mean, somewhere he saw it as an opportunity. And it's only when you're comfortable with the idea you're selling that you can sell it so well.
I think Rippan's whole thing was that if you touch people somewhere, if you touch on their basic sense of goodness and sense of caring, then the money comes. So you don't have to make the fund collection a business. What you have to do is to reach out to people with an effective message.
To tell you the truth, I was a little, skeptical. Is this going to work? Because till then, most of us who were in this field thought raising money within the country meant going for large donations to big companies, etc. But here was a young man saying, you know, he was going to raise funds through small donations, touch a lot of people. He had such a dream.
I was really quite electrified by the idea that there was this very young man who was so enthused with a particular idea, and that there were a whole team of young people giving of their own time. They were still working out of, I think, Rippan's mother's flat in those days, and it was just a tiny operation. And they said, would you give us a painting? That was, I think, somewhere around 1980. And I said, gladly. I mean, that's the least I can do. So I gave this little painting of a head. And 6 months later, I think they used it for their first series of cards. And 6 months later, Rippan got back to me and he said, Anjali, we made so much money out of that card.
He came quickly to the point. He asked you flat out, you know, that look here, this is for Cry and no shilly-shallying, the answer has to be yes.
The Art for Cry event and everything that went with it, the communication materials, the publicity that it attracted, the artists that participated in it, that was really, to me at least, the turning point for Cry in terms of visibility.
Everybody was so bothered about Art for Cry. They were not looking beyond it because Art for Cry was the thing in front of them. And suddenly, in the midst of all this, he gets up and says, what will happen after Art for Cry? When all the money will come in, what are we going to do about it?
With Rippan, it would be somebody who'd talk to him almost casually and he'd say, well, come on, let's start. What do you need? Some chap would say, we need durries for our kids to sleep on, and he'd get in touch and bully some friend's father who manufactured durries, and there, on the spot, that was done.
That was what came through in the early years when we worked directly with him. That if he was convinced that the funding was needed for a program, there would be hardly any delays between the approach and the takeoff of the project.
Rippan always thought that he is there because of them and not the other way around. So he used to be so humble and so quiet and always been in awe of those people.
Every time he went to a project, he would come back and tell us, you people don't know what it's like to suffer hardships. Go out there, live there, and then come back and tell me that you're having a tough time. You have it so easy. Just keep telling us that.
He was visibly moved by them. He spoke to them very softly, very gently. And we used to be worried because at that moment, whatever they asked, we could give.
I'd asked government for the funding, and they had said there was no funding for training of NGOs, only for welfare work.
And I went to him with this proposal, and I said, as I said, in 2 weeks I had it cleared. And we started training the NGOs. And the Central Social Welfare Board after that found it worked so well, it's now part of their regular programming. That's pioneering.
Right through the night, he'd be thinking up all these various ideas because he couldn't sleep. And that was his most creative time at night. And then he'd call up, you know, in the morning, guess what? Just think of what I thought today. Just try and guess. And you'd go, no, Rippan, I can't guess. And he'd come with 10 ideas. So finally, I remember Shanaz and he got together and told him, now we're going to give you really strong sleeping tablets so you sleep at night because you can't handle your ideas anymore for a few days.
He was the most obsessed human being I have ever met. And he would drive you crazy with that obsession. See, because Rippan basically ate, thought, slept, dreamt, cry. And he had this really exasperating tendency to demand that you do the same. And almost sort of questioning your commitment if you didn't. I think this was one of the characteristics that I found hardest to deal with him. That he wanted you to be as obsessed as he was. And he'd feel hurt if you pointed that out to him and said, look, I don't need to be this obsessed. You need to be obsessed, you know. You please carry on being obsessed.
He was pressurizing himself as well as others. You know, that urgency to go ahead and achieve what he had already seen. You know, it was difficult for him because he had seen already what he wanted.
He always wanted to go faster and faster. And what he could not realize was social change is not fast. So the results from social work will be very slow as compared to, let's say, fundraising.
He never claimed to know that this was the right way to do it. You know, that was never his attitude. His attitude was, it has to be done, and this is the way I'm doing it, you know. If you guys have some other way to do it, then you should have done it before I got into it.
I don't think anyone could influence Rippan, if you ask me honestly. Not really. I think he had his own way of being, and he'd go on saying, yes, 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 you know, if you said something to him. And I always thought to him, I used to say to him, Rippan, why am I saying this to you? You're not paying the slightest attention.
I find this common to people who make large changes happen, that they are not looking at a destination at all, which is why they do so much without getting frustrated. They keep seeing it as continuous activity, which they will do as long as they live, and they hope will carry on beyond them. But the reason why they're able to sustain themselves when a lesser person gives up saying, what difference have I made? Rippan and people like him have dealt with that question long ago. They made sure that question is not part of their domain of living. It's, what have I done doesn't come in.
He has come for this thing. You know, when I feel, I read the thing, then I feel that he only come to do this work. And he has done a quite big work.
What I can do, I must do. And I think there you are. What an extraordinary thing for someone so young to say with that conviction, so that it's become, as I say, a maxim. You can put it up, you know, in quotes, and eventually you'll think immediately of Rippan.
Thank you.
is really an opportunity. An opportunity for you to do something to give our children a better future. And so whatever it is you will be doing, whether you will be typing or writing books of accounts or anything, it will all be work put in for children. And if you give off your best, certainly it will make more of a difference to their lives and to yours, and what you will feel at the end of the day. Our work is not easy. Sometimes it's very, very difficult. But knowing who it's for will certainly make it easier.
What he was feeling, thinking, as early as he was 10 years old, has been the motivation of his life and has been kept all along his life. And today, after maybe 15 years or less that CRY exists, CRY is known all over India, and CRY is known even abroad. And I must say for Rippan that it has been done only by his conviction.
Organizations like CRY are trying to address some of the most difficult and complex problems that this society or any society faces. And you simply can't do that on the cheap. So you have to have the ability to attract first-rate talent and professionals to work on development issues and problems, problems of poverty, problems of kids in bonded labor. You know, all the good intentions in the world are not going to make a difference unless they're combined with the kind of professional talent and sophistication that's required to be effective.
You take Bal Sawal. I mean, Bal Sawal was an event that, yes, it was, I think it was Rippan's basic dream or idea to do something child to child. You know, that was his idea. But it started out as a mela, which he was really involved in, and he had done a lot. I mean, he was very, very involved in the conceptualizing of the mela and all of that. But when it changed, when we didn't get the support for the mela and it changed, I remember he just left it to the steam and cry, you know. And it was a group that really conceptualized the event, developed the event, planned the event, chose the artists. Everything was done by this group. And we went back to Rippan with the detailed plan. And he looked at it, he liked it, he went with it. He gave us his, you know, his few insights. And then he just let us be.
What did upset him very, very much was that if the people he had employed or he had put his trust in or he had put his expectations didn't somehow live up to his expectations, that really sent him into a tizz.
What would happen is he would go through a period of internal anguish, an internal debate. And he would keep coming back to you like a dog with a bone. And saying, no, but why do you say this? No, I don't agree. Explain it to me again. You know, you would have fights, arguments, debates, quarrels. Maybe you didn't speak to each other for a couple of days, but he never let go of the issue. He genuinely grappled with it.
That's really a tribute to Rippan and his particular style of leadership, which was a collective style of leadership. It wasn't personalized in the way that many founders of NGOs tend to be the charismatic leader. And Rippan, I think, really saw CRY as having a broad base of people of ownership in the organization.
I was drawn to support something that he had created independent of his existence almost. You know, it didn't really matter that it was Rippan Kapur, you know, it was CRY.
After he gone, all the things has come out. Otherwise, he didn't like that sometimes some people come. If I, by mistake, Tekna, he is the founder of the CRY. What has happened to you? Why you are advertising me?
He understood, I think, instinctively, his contribution to inspiring CRY. I mean, it would be foolish if he were not aware of it. And what he really wondered was whether this would be continued after he left. And I was trying to reassure him that he has built himself a team of people which really were bound to carry on the momentum that had been created and the kind of spirit which he had infused through the organization. He didn't have to worry.
He was a special person, so his personality was such that it was infectious quite naturally. So as he did, we did.
I just so marveled at in those last months was how beautifully he'd sort of observed how CRY was handling itself, and I think it was greatly fulfilling to him to see that it would be there always, long after he wouldn't. And that's exactly how he had looked at it anyway.
This whole thing of him lying there in the hospital bed and virtually directing the whole show, you know, there was very little he could do, but there were people bringing him things and doing things that he wanted and feeding him stuff that he could barely keep down. And I have never seen somebody finally go with so much love and so much care and so many, you know, so much warm human feelings around him.
It was typical of him to go on a Sunday so that it harmed the least number of people. He didn't even have to give an off on to cry on that day. And he didn't want a big fuss, the funeral. And
I thought I dealt with it all, you know. And yes, I'd accepted it and all of that. But I realize now that that I guess one never really deals with it until it really happens. And now I realize, how much I miss that daily fix or whatever.
And he just opened the cage and I let him go. And I just stood there and I looked at him like, I don't believe you did this. These little things to me at that time were like the worst thing anybody could ever do to me, you know. And he next day, he behaved like everything was okay, like nothing had ever happened. I still want to be like him in many ways, because as I said earlier, he was, I think, well-rounded as a person, you know. He was not too much of anything. He was fun, childlike, he could be serious when he had to be. I mean, he threw his tantrums, he got angry. He was not perfect, and still, I mean, you tend to elevate people, you know, who do things like these charity type of, like, cry and all, into positions of saints, like, they're, like, totally pure and, you know, but that wasn't Rippan. He was just a normal man. I wouldn't call him ordinary because I don't find him one bit ordinary. Who had all his bad qualities and all his good qualities, and who still did so much, you know, and that really, you know, gives you, like, it really encourages me that, you know, you don't have to be great, you don't have to be, like, popular or famous or anything. If you believe in something, you go ahead and do it, you know, and that's what, you know, that's what he did.